Hello and welcome to Family Matters, a joint production between the Bowen Center for the Study of the Family and the University of the District of Columbia. I'm Dr. Roberta Holt from the Bowen Center, your host for Family Matters. Each of us comes from some version of a family system that influences how we become who we are. This in turn sets the stage for how we relate to others. Regardless of our families, all of us struggle with many of the same issues and kinds of relationships. Through this series, you will hear from people who have had experience in helping families with a variety of relationship issues. Each one will bring a special perspective to the subject under consideration. We also will consider particular issues of concern to families, and this will include surviving teenage children, marital conflict, obesity, violence in the family, substance abuse, immigration and its effect on families, and other subjects. Today, I'm privileged to have as my guest Dr. Roberta Gilbert, who is on the faculty of the Georgetown Family Center, now known as the Bowen Center for the Study of the Family. Dr. Gilbert was born in Indiana and was raised in Illinois, a solidly Midwestern gal. She attended medical school and completed her residency at the University of Buffalo in New York. And then after that, she did postgraduate training at the famed Menninger Clinic in Kansas. While at Menninger, she became interested in the ideas being developed by Dr. Murray Bowen at Georgetown and moved to D.C., where she's been a member of the faculty of the Bowen Center since 1988. Since then, Dr. Gilbert has been a prolific writer. Her first book, Extraordinary Relationships, was published in 1992 and has been going strong ever since. Very few books achieve a 14-year track record for sales. This volume was followed by Connecting with Our Children, Guiding Principles for Parents in a Troubled World. Then in 2004, she published Eight Concepts of Bowen Theory. She has just heard from the printer that her new book, Extraordinary Leadership, will be out before Christmas this year. In addition to a faculty appointment at the Family Center, Dr. Gilbert was on the medical staff at Arlington Hospital. Currently, she is in private practice and conducts ongoing leadership seminars for clergy in Virginia. Welcome, Dr. Gilbert.
Thank you, Dr. Holt.
I wanted to have you on this show, and I particularly wanted the theme to be extraordinary relationships, because I thought that that is such a nice, broad topic for one of our beginning shows, because it's more encompassing than some of our specific themes like obesity or autism or something like that. The title also is fascinating to me. How did you get the title? Is this something that you, a publisher gave you, or is it something that that you conceptualize as what you were trying to do with the book?
Well, actually, I woke up with it one morning. I had been wondering what to name this book. I thought I had written a pretty good book, but I wanted something short and pithy that would capture what I was trying to do in the book, and that is help people to get to a better level of relationships. And it just came suddenly one morning.
Well, it's nice because it's on the positive side of things. It's not healing your broken relationship, it is how do you get to something that you would like to have that is extraordinary, which I think is sort of a unique tilt.
Exactly.
How do you explain why this thing has been selling for 14 years? It started out with a very, very small publisher, didn't it?
It did.
What's its history?
It started out with Chronomed Publisher, and Chronomed was taken over by John Wiley and Sons in 3 or 4 years ago. The oldest publisher of books in the United States. So it's kind of a privilege to be with Wiley.
But how do you explain its longevity? In other words, there have been plenty of books that hit the stands are, you know, couple, almost months, I mean, and then they're gone. They just don't hang around. What about this book do you think?
You know, probably the author is the last person to know. But I can tell you what people tell me. They say, this makes sense to me. Everything else I've ever read, or any counselor I've ever gone to, didn't make that much sense to me as this book does. Or they'll say, this book saved our marriage. Or they'll say, this is a new way of thinking, and it's changing my life. And of course, we owe that to a mentor, that one of the early pioneers of family theory, Dr. Murray Bowen. And I was trying to report really on the theory that he gave us.
Well, what about this book then? When those people make those comments about having read other books, and now they've read your book, how do you think this thing differs?
The subtitle of the book is A New Way of Thinking About Human Interactions. And it truly is a new way of thinking. It's a broader way of thinking. It tries to take in more of the players. The whole family is seen as the unit, not just the individual or even the couple, but the whole family is looked at as an emotional unit that interacts, sort of like the cells in our body do with each other. And so it's truly a different way of looking at things. There are a lot of therapists out there who have been trained in this way of thinking. They seem to love to give it to their clients. Professors seem to love to teach from it. Other than that, I don't know what to say.
So it largely has been in the textbook market, pretty much.
Textbook and therapists.
Mm-hmm. And word of mouth.
And word of mouth.
Because I haven't really seen it advertised anywhere.
It really hasn't been.
Right.
It's kind of made it on its own.
Well, it did. That's why I think it's so interesting.
Yeah.
Very few books have that kind of staying power, and I thought it would be, when I was doing the math for the introduction and I realized it was 14 years, I thought, well, this deserves a little exploration. So, mm-hmm. Well, what is the core of the book? How do you think about what an extraordinary relationship is?
Well, we learned early by watching families that they were prone, family, this emotional unit called the family, was prone to get into several different patterns when they would become anxious with each other. They would fight, or they would distance from each other, or they would start telling each other what to do, over-functioning, under-functioning, or they would start acting helpless, or they would call in somebody else, triangle in someone else. So I thought, what would a relationship look like that didn't include any of that, didn't include any of these patterns that we've learned about from watching families in trouble? And so I originally thought it would be an equal relationship. Nobody would be telling anybody what to do. They would be equals. They would be on an equal footing with each other. They would be open. There would be nothing they couldn't talk about. And they would be separate. They would know where I stopped and you began. They would have boundaries. They would know what I will do, what I won't do, so forth. And they would have good boundaries. And so that's how I described it in the middle part of the book: separate, equal, and open.
These are great goals to have. Are you thinking of them as in the abstract, or do you see them as theoretically possible to attain?
Well, I don't think anybody is perfect, and no relationship is perfect. At least I haven't seen it yet. I certainly haven't been in any. But what I have seen is, by having this goal, people do better and better and better and better over years of time, really. They don't do it in a weekend. They don't do it in a week or even maybe in a year. But over years of time, people do step up in their relationship functioning, and the family systems, the new way of thinking, really gives them guidelines for how to conduct themselves in their relationships. So, yes, I've seen people do radically better with their relationships, including myself.
Well, I want to get at the guidelines in a minute, but you're using something in here that almost sounds like intention, that the intent for things to get better has some importance. rather than just kind of drifting through life and doing the best you can with it as it, that there
yeah.
isn't.
There's well, you could think, well, maybe I could avoid the divorce, but we could struggle on the rest of our lives.
And be miserable.
Oh, and be miserable. Be miserable together. Or I could avoid getting fired, but I could maybe not get along with anybody at work. But I think my goal and the goal in thinking systems is, let's do avoid the divorce, but then let's go on and see how much better we can make it all the time. And so that's been an interesting journey. Or let's avoid getting fired. Yes, that's a good thing. But on the job,
if you like a paycheck,
you like food on the table, it helps a lot. But then let's see how good we can get along with people at that job. Can that actually get better and better and better? It's really the only way of thinking that I had studied a lot of ways of thinking, and most of them were concerned with let's get people rid of their symptoms. Let's get them rid of their schizophrenia or their anxiety attacks or this or that. But I had never come up against a way of thinking that would say, let's keep working on this the rest of our lives and just get better and better and better in our functioning with other people. Well, how refreshing.
I hear that. And what would you consider then the essence of some of these guidelines? In other words, a person, generally speaking, people do, I think, do the best that they can with their lives, with whatever they're in. And they try in all kinds of ways until they reach exhaustion, and that's usually the point at which they call a therapist.
Exactly.
Because they've tried everything they know to do.
Right.
So how would you think about guidelines then that are viable, that would be, I'll call it useful or viable?
Yes. Well, one of the first things we learned was that feelings and emotions and anxiety keep circulating around and around and around the members of a family or a group, such as a work group. For example, my husband used to come home, get very anxious, take it out on me, as I saw it. And then I would get very anxious and upset. Well, he would feel better.
But
I felt terrible. He wanted to go out and play. And I thought, well, what a perverse person. He's got me all upset. And now he wants to go out and play. I didn't understand that's the nature of the beast. It's the nature of a human system to move the emotion from one to the other to the other. Had I understood that, A, I could have worked with myself differently. B, I wouldn't have been blaming him quite so much for feeling good when he offloaded to me. And so I would have understood that there was something I could do with me to make this thing better. But what I had been taught in my training and in the various therapists that I saw for this situation was, tell your feelings. Let's get these feelings out. So I would start offloading my feelings, my bad feelings, onto him. That's what the training said to do.
Yeah, express your feelings.
I was,
exactly. Don't bottle them up. You may.
Well, he didn't like it. I didn't. And so now we were off and running and escalating more and more and more and having lots of trouble. But I was doing what I was being taught. It simply didn't work. When I saw the feelings and the expressing the feelings as the solution. And actually,
what is the problem? In other words, that proscription is well-intentioned and it's almost universal in the training. And what is the core of why it doesn't work? What? In other words, it was intended to do something,
well,
but it's not achieving its intention.
I think it came from a misunderstanding. If one goes to a therapist and says, I feel bad, and spends an hour telling the therapist how they feel bad, at the end of an hour, they'll feel better. Now, the therapist might not feel so good.
We hope they've had enough training that they do.
But if they've had a lot of training and if they are a certain type of person, they will not take it too seriously. Once my analyst said, who listens? But at any rate, I think in the therapist's office, people would go out feeling better. And so the therapy profession learned from that, dang, that's something we can teach people. We can teach them to offload their feelings to each other and they'll feel better. Well, what worked in a professional relationship, I believe, did not work at home or at work, because it simply would escalate the problem. It would move one's intensities into the system. Then I had my system to deal with.
If people care about you, they're going to get involved with it.
Exactly. And they don't do what the well-trained therapist does, which is to stay calm and not take it too seriously. They do take it very seriously at home and at work. And so that never worked very well in real live relationships other than the therapy room. That's what I think, where it all got off the track. But our society bought into it. So you had families sitting around telling their feelings to each other, blowing up at each other, going on to divorce much of the time. You had workplaces where the consultant would come in and coach everyone to say how they felt in the workplace. I've seen workplaces destroy, self-destruct, as a result of all that.
I have too. I think I've even been part of one of those systems.
Interesting.
Yeah. So the other components then of this, kind of the things that you think go into extraordinary systems would be what kinds of things?
Extraordinary relationships. The other components, other than moving things into a way of thinking that teaches me how to deal with these feelings that go round and round and round. So now already I have a guideline. If I know that feelings are going around and around a system, one of my guidelines becomes I have choices. I have choices about moving my feelings around to other people, my emotions. I also have choices about taking on emotions of other people. Well, isn't that interesting? So now I have a guideline that says I can work to stay calm when the other is upset. Well, then I took this learning back to my practice and I started teaching people this sort of thing, and I saw marriages turn around. Marriages that were heading for the divorce court suddenly began to do much better. When even one person in the family could hear this and start managing themselves just a little bit differently. Not taking all these intense feelings quite so seriously.
Well, that's a pretty tall order.
Tis.
If people get their feelings jangled when they hear somebody that they think a lot of, their significant other, whoever that is, a parent, a child, anybody, that's a pretty tall order to be more calm when you are with somebody, or to not take on the feelings as much. And I would think they would interpret it that you don't care for me as much as you used to.
And they do sometimes, temporarily.
Yes. Okay.
They will sometimes temporarily. But we find that that's a temporary thing. And shortly after that, both people go on to a better level of dealing with each other. It's very interesting to watch it. And it is hard. It's a tall order to not get upset when someone you love is getting very upset. And maybe at you.
And you may be interpreted as not understanding the problem.
Exactly. Exactly. But another guideline is stay connected. Don't just walk out of the room when somebody's upset or angry or whatever kind of intensity it may take. But stay connected. Just don't take on the upset. So how do I do that? How do I stay connected, keep talking with them, keep involved, and yet not take on the upset? And again, a very tall order.
Well, I think the hardest thing to do is to stay connected to the distancers, to the ones who do leave and slam the door, because they need their space.
Right.
And if you close in on that space, you can get violence.
Right.
And then what do you do? And then what do you do with somebody who is so mad at you that they're going to distance, either emotionally or physically, for how many, you know, how many days or whatever, however.
Well, and a little distance can be a good thing for a short period. It can be very helpful.
In what kinds of ways?
Well, you just mentioned one, violence. Sometimes people feel their temper is rising and they need to get out of the room and they need to take a break. And so a little distance can be a very good thing. Where the two people become permanently distant, then that's a different matter.
I hear you. That leads into the people that come in that say the relationship has died.
Exactly.
Yeah. Right. What other guidelines? We're getting close to time here.
Well, managing the feelings and would be one. I think this thing of open communications is a wonderful one. Just keeping the dialogue going, not necessarily all the time, but a significant amount of the time, and that'll vary in different families, of course. But very high-level relationships can talk about most anything, and they can count on each other to take it the right way or to not become unnecessarily upset by the communication. So an openness is very useful. We could do a whole show, I suppose, on just that one thing. Communication, you know, what is that like? How does that look?
Or even on what is an open relationship.
Mm-hmm.
What are the characteristics of that? Because I can think, I mean, it almost sounds like it is counter to what we talked about earlier, that if you can't express your feelings, or if you're not expressing your feelings, you don't have an open relationship. So there has to be a missing ingredient here about how you express your feelings in an open relationship in which it enhances the relationship versus that it bogs it down. The other one flees from you or distances from you or whatever the mechanism is in the relationship.
Mm-hmm.
And that's a terribly tricky thing to negotiate.
Well, it is, and we've all been taught how important these feelings are. But in family systems theory, we also learned that, yes, they feel very intense and they feel very important, but they do come and go. They come and they go. And our culture has put a huge emphasis on our feelings to the point where our culture seems to guide, coach people, run your life by your feelings. If it feels right, do it.
At the expense of any kind of principles.
At the expense of any principles or any other guidelines, thinking guidelines. And so you can really have a wonderful relationship with a minimum of talking about feelings in some marriages that I've seen. The feelings don't come up that much. They're there, but they get managed.
Once they get married, managed, you are on a different plane.
Mm-hmm.
You have more energy left over to do other things.
Exactly. And then life becomes very exciting and very fulfilling
mm-hmm.
when people start having more energy to do what they want to do. But many people live this lifestyle of the relationships absorb and consume all of their energy. It's all they have time and energy for because of the anxiety involved.
As example, by people who come in and that's all they want to do is talk. We've got to find time to sit down and talk about the relationship.
Exactly.
Rather than it just is, and it's working.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. Just do yourself better in it. Do myself better.
It's kind of a red flag when you get to the point that all you can talk about is the relationship.
Right.
That is a giant red flag.
Well, it's in our society. Mm-hmm. I think.
Absolutely.
I went to a workshop once long before I learned about family systems theory. And the convener of the workshop was saying it was about marriage. Well, I don't know maybe about relationships. And he was saying, well, my wife and I, twice a year, we go off to a nice place and we work on our relationship.
Okay.
I thought, wow, that would be hard.
Well, I think we've covered some interesting ideas here today. The idea, the open relationship and the whole thing about managing feelings are so critical for all of us. And I do appreciate your input into all this and hope you'll come again sometime.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Keep talking.